If you have your Bibles, please turn with me to Hebrews chapter 10, and we're going to look today at verses 19 to 24. Well, one night I was in my bedroom sleeping, and I got woken up by the creaking open of the door. There was no voice, no other sounds, except this light shuffling of footsteps. And those sounds get nearer and nearer to me, and the next thing I know is that my bed bounced. And then something warm got up the bed and crawled to between my wife and I. It settled itself there, and the surprising thing is that my wife and I both just slept through the night, because we know it is Matthias, our youngest son, who has just come into our room and come to sleep with us, between us. My sons, Sean and Matthias, have unlimited full access to where we are. This morning, we're going to look at access. How children of the living God have full and unlimited access to our Father, which is in heaven. See, the book of Hebrews is about Jesus Christ. What did Jesus do? Jesus came to give us access to the holy God. He came to reconcile sinful men to the holy God. And that is the revolutionary thought in the book of Hebrews. See, for a long time, the Jews, the Hebrews, they knew that there is no access to God, or access to God is extremely limited. You will know that they were very focused on the worship in the temple or the tabernacle. And as we've learned, these are structures speak of one thing. They speak about barriers, hindrances, no access. And if you trespass, death happens to you. So the Old Testament and the Old Covenant is a message of barriers and denials. But when Jesus came, He took away all those barriers and gave a new and living way by which man can now draw near to God. So the author tells us we have confidence to enter the holy places. Now we can. The holy places, the places where the special presence of God resides. And so how does He do this? He does this by shedding His blood and by giving His body. We learned earlier that without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sins. Jesus had to shed blood in order to wash us of our sins. And His body, His flesh, was broken that we may now enter the most holy place. Now this is a picture taken from the tabernacle. For those of you who were here, you will know that between the holy place and the most holy place, what we will call the Holy of Holies, is this curtain, this veil, this thick piece of cloth that keeps everyone out from the most holy place, except for the great high priest. So this thick veil stands as a barrier. And as far as we know, the veil or the curtain is something very impressive. It is 18 meters tall. Can you imagine that? 18 meters tall and 10 centimeters thick. So it's not just a sash, it's a thick thing, huge thing. 18 meters tall, 10 cm thick. And the Bible says when Jesus died, in Matthew 27, the veil was ripped into two from top to bottom. You say, what's the significance? It meant that it could not be the work of man. It had to be the work of God. And God is, in a sense, telling and signifying to the world, with the death of Jesus, my son, with the breaking of His body, the way into the most holy place is now open. So because of Jesus, we now have a new and living way, access to God. The word new is very interesting. The word new is freshly slaughtered. Whoa, it's a freshly slaughtered way. Now, when the writer wrote about this, Jesus had died at least 30 years ago. But he says it is still a freshly slaughtered way. And even until today, it is a freshly slaughtered way because it is still effective and available. We serve a living, risen Savior. The message in totality so far in Hebrews is that you and I, because of Jesus Christ, we have full access to God. No more barriers. No more hindrances. Not even your sin, because Jesus paid it all. So you say, Pastor, what difference then does it make to you, my life and your life? Well, this is where the author continues. In verses 22, 23, 24, 25, the author, in fact, for the rest of this book, is going to tell us the practical implications of this full access. But this morning, we're going to focus on three privileges and indeed responsibilities you and I have because of what Jesus has done, this new and living way. The first thing I'd like you to note is with this full access, we can now draw near to God. Very simple. Now that you have a way, please draw near, please come to God. I think one of the most tragic things in life is if my sons are living with me in the same house and I grant them free access, and they should never take that access. It would be such a sad thing if I know that my kids could come to me, but they will never talk to me. They will never enjoy themselves with myself. They will never ask me for help. What a tragedy it will be. And what a tragedy it is if Christians who have access to the Heavenly Father will not draw near to God. So the author says, the first and most natural implication is draw near to God. With this full access, come to God, enjoy Him, seek Him, pray to Him. See, the word draw near is mentioned here in verse 22. Let us, now seeing that Jesus has given us access, seeing this new and living way, then let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith. This drawing near is a commonly repeated motif in Hebrews. What it means? Well, there are seven occurrences actually in the book of Hebrews, but let me just give you two other references in this book. For example, Hebrews 4:16. Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. What does it mean to draw near? Well, very clearly in Hebrews 4, it means to pray, in essence. Do you know prayer is a very intimate exercise? It is. When you pray to God, in reality, you are drawing near to God. You are seeking His presence. You are having a personal communion and interaction with Him. Now, today we live in a world where we are very easily distracted. So, in a table conversation, it would not be a surprise if you are talking to people and they are playing their phones. So we may have this mindset, oh, if I'm talking to God, God has so many things to take care of. Well, he has billions of people to look at. He has all the cycles and all the machines and all the atoms to look at. Will He listen to me? The Bible tells us God hears your prayer. You have His full attention. But how can God do that? He is God. You are not. So when you draw near to God, it is a very personal, intimate time with your Abba Father. So do draw near. That's what He's saying. Let us come, ask of God. Don't for a moment think God is too busy to hear you. Don't for a moment think you can't, because Jesus has opened the way. Not only should we pray to God, but we should seek Him for who He is. I think the other reference I mentioned here in Hebrews 11 is about drawing near and how it is parallel to seeking Him. So we don't just seek God for things, but we seek God, we draw near to God for Himself. We draw near to God for God. We're not just drawing near to God for things. Because the Bible does tell us, in your presence there is fullness of joy, at your right hand are pleasures forever. But there's a deep joy in seeking Him. There is a satisfaction of your soul when you draw near to Him. So the author says, this is the deep need of human heart, that we would have the privilege to pray, we would have the privilege to commune and to enjoy God. So he says, come, let us draw near. And you don't have to be scared, you don't have to be ashamed, because there is that full assurance of faith, not in what you are or who you are or what you have done, but full assurance in what Jesus has done. Now you don't have to be scared, terrified. You know, there are people who are very scared to pray. You ask them to pray. I don't dare to pray. Well, let me say this. You don't have to be scared of praying. Just like a son doesn't need to be scared of asking his daddy. Now, my son's English is terrible. At least the younger one. He asks terribly bad grammar, bad English. Sometimes asks for wrong things. But, you know, he's not scared of asking his father. Because he knows, I'm his father. How many of you have seen a son ask his father this way? Oh, most revered and respected high father, I tremble at your presence. You're holy, no, holy. You're mighty, you're awesome, you're powerful, and I'm so unworthy to come before you, my father. I'm scared I'm going to say the wrong thing, so I ask you for forgiveness in advance. But if it is possible, can I please beseech you, can I have an ice cream, please? No son goes to the father, a good father, that way. No one. He comes to the daddy and says, Papa, can I have an ice cream? Free access, draws near, not afraid, not scared. Now, let me balance this out. I'm not saying that when we come to God, there is no fear in our hearts. No. The proper approach to our God, our Father, is both the fear of God and the confidence in the love of God. It's both. But it's certainly not a slavish fear, as if we are not good enough. You've got to come to terms to know you are indeed not good enough, but Jesus is good enough, and He paid the price for you. So we have to draw near in this full assurance. I want to say, if you really know Jesus today, draw near. Don't just draw near on Sunday morning. Draw near regularly, daily, in your life, in your prayers, in reading His Word, in seeking Him, enjoying Him, spending time with Him, praising Him. The author says this worship of God, this fellowship with God is now available, and so come and draw near. So number one, it should change your life this way. You have a deep intimacy or possibility, an avenue of intimacy with God, your Abba Father. Because Jesus told us this is how you need to pray. Our Father, which art in heaven. Radical change from the Old Testament times where nobody dares to pray Father. But secondly, we're going to look at how this new and living way, this access to God, is to enable us to hold tight in hope. Hold tight in hope. Because life is not always easy. In fact, I believe the Christian life is one where many trials and afflictions come. So in those times, what do you do? Well, don't give up, don't jump ship, but hold tight. Life is going to be like a roller coaster, but as you go up and down the life roller coaster, you don't jump out of the roller coaster, you keep believing, you keep hanging on. But at the very same time, you hang on to the bars, to the rails in front of you, isn't it? And let me give you a picture of people who really hold tight in the roller coaster of life. I love this boy. Classic face. He is scared, terrified. But you know, what is he doing? He's holding tight. He holds tight. Life is scary sometimes. When your doctor tells you have this incurable cancer. Life is scary sometimes when all your funds are wiped out in a bad business deal. Life is very scary when your wife walks out on you or when your kid turns his back towards you. God doesn't guarantee immunity from difficulties. Nowhere in the scripture But he does tell you that when you go through the difficulties, I am with you. And you can hold on to me, that your soul may be preserved and that you will keep believing. That's why the author says, let us hold fast, hold tight the confession of our hope without wavering. For he who promised is faithful. Now, he's faithful to do what? Is he faithful in a sense that we have the expectation he must always deliver us out of difficulties? No. There are some Christians who live their entire life in difficulty and die a tragic death. They are. God has not been unfaithful, because his faithfulness is that to preserve your soul unto the end. In fact, all these trials and afflictions is God working for you a far more exceeding weight of glory in the future that is to come. He remains faithful. So when we hope in God, when we hang on to God, it's not that hanging on to say, God, you must heal me. He may not, but God will definitely save you. And God will definitely bless you. That's the promise. This promise is rooted in God himself. And this ability to hang on to God is only open to those who have access to God. Earlier on in Hebrews 6, we note, we have this as a sure and steadfast anchor of the soul, and this hope enters into the inner place behind the curtain. So this hope is not for everyone. This hope is not for everyone. Only those who have access. Only those who have Jesus in their life. Then they have the right, the privilege to come to the most holy place, to the very presence of God and say, God, I'm hanging on to you. I don't want to jump out of the roller coaster. I trust you. I'll hang on tight. It's scary, Lord. It's scary to go through this sickness. It's scary to go through all these trials, but I hang on to you and I know at the end it will be okay. Just as John Lennon says, everything will be okay in the end, and if it is not okay, it is not the end. God has promised good to you and me. It will be okay in the end. It will be fantastic in the end. Now, you must understand that the book of Hebrews is not a theoretical thesis written to people who are sitting in an ivory tower. This book of Hebrews is intensely practical because it's written to people who are going through persecution. They're being abused, bullied, mistreated for believing in Jesus. And the author says, keep on trusting, hoping, clinging. Because he repeats that many times in Hebrews 3:6. You've got to hold fast again to the hope. In Hebrews 6:11 and 12, we desire each one of you to show the same earnestness, to have the full assurance of hope unto the keep on clinging on. Keep on believing. And he says in 6:18, hold fast to the hope. So without a shadow of a doubt, he's writing to a people who are probably on the brink. Scary. They're so discouraged that the author says, don't give up. You have access. Jesus paid it all. You now can go to God, into the most holy place, and you can keep on trusting him. Some of you today are really going through crushing circumstances. You feel like you're on a roller coaster. You feel like you're being tossed. You're getting giddy, nauseous, seasick on a sea of trials. Now, God didn't say, I'm going to take you out of the sea of trials. But God says, I'm offering myself to be the anchor of your soul as you go through these trials. So that as you're tossed to and fro, you're still anchored in the rock. And that's what he wants to give you today. Possible because Jesus has given us access. So what do we do when we have access? Well, you draw near to God. Practical, daily communion, praise, prayer. You hang on, you keep trusting, you keep clinging, you don't give up on your faith. And lastly, you love one another. So you draw near, you hold fast, you love. Now, some of you may notice right away, hey, Pastor, today you're not very on form. Usually you PPP or SSS or TTT one. Hey, how today like that? Well, I stuck to this because I think this is exactly what the text says. And for those who say, hey, very hard to remember, I tell you, I was tempted to call this the DHL sermon. Draw near, hold fast, love one another. It's as simple as it comes. But if there is something to help you even further, is this. Notice that the first privilege and responsibility is to have that full assurance of faith. The second responsibility and privilege is that of hope. The last is that of love. These are the three great manifestations of real faith in Christ. Faith, hope, love. Paul mentions this in 1 Corinthians 13. So we're going to look lastly, thirdly, at love. What does it mean to love one another? Now, there's so much to be looked at here that I'm going to split this into two parts. So this is just part one. There'll be more part two next Sunday. To love one another is not some nebulous, sweet, sentimental, syrupy feeling. Sometimes that's how we define it. Love one another, according to the writer here, is to consider how to stir up one another to love and good works. Now, love certainly involves a lot more than that, such as giving to someone in need, giving physical help to someone in need, being a companion to someone who is lonely. Now, that's all expressions of love properly so. But there's one aspect that the author here highlights, and that is to consider how to stir up one another to love and good works. In other words, it's a ministry of getting them onto action and really higher spiritual ground, helping them grow and to go. Real love helps another brother to grow and to go. That's as simple as that. So if you say you love God, question is, are you helping someone else, not just yourself? Are you helping someone else grow in their spiritual life and take on new ventures of faith for the glory of God? That's love. That's love. And we all have to be challenged in this assessment. Are we really fulfilling this? Now, the Bible uses a very interesting word, the word stir up. Stir up. Well, this is the picture you have, stir up. But actually, that's not the exact meaning of the word itself. In the Greek, the word is actually to poke with something sharp. You know what love is? You try it on people beside you, I poke you. No, don't, please don't do that. To love one another means we poke one another. Now, it is translated provoke in the King James. Otherwise, it could be seen as to irritate or to agitate. Very strange. To love one another, you irritate, you agitate one another. Yes, but you don't irritate the person to anger. But you irritate the person to action. The picture is that, I think, of a stubborn, lazy cow. And you're right, every one of us is like a cow. Lazy, sitting there. Whole day like that. Eat, just eat. All we do is eat. Very comfortable. Don't want to work, no. Just stay there. And maybe some of us are like that, like come to church just to eat the sermon, but after that, don't do work. So this is where the poking comes in. Then you move a bit, you pull the plow for a while, you stop. Then another guy comes and poke you and you get to work again and you move along. That's the idea, because we are lazy. And we need one another to provoke us, agitate us, irritate us, so that we don't stay in our comfort zones. But we get out and we grow and we go for the glory of God. Be an irritator. Be an agitator to get people to get moving for God. Now again, please, don't say, Pastor say, I need to agitate you and irritate you, and you go around to do that for a wrong reason. No, this is for a God-centered reason. Now, in order for us to then stir up, provoke, agitate one another, the Bible says you need to consider. Think about others. So often we are so focused on ourselves, and we are all guilty of that. We are so focused on ourselves that we don't think about others. But real love is a consideration for others. It means you've got to pay attention to others. You've got to look at their lives. You've got to watch their struggles. You've got to notice their absence. You've got to watch their body posture. And you think about them. You pay attention to them. And indeed, you spend time getting to hear them and to know them. You see, you won't be a good agitator if you're not thinking and spending time with one another. You can't. It's all very superficial. So the author is very wise. He says you need to consider. Then you can go and help, can provoke. And by the way, this is not just done by your pastor. This is to be done by everyone, because the Bible says one another. This is not a unique ministry. Yes, I hope I'm poking you today. Poke, 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 poke. Oh, very uncomfortable with the sermon. Ayo. I hope I'm poking you somewhat, so that for this week, you don't be like a lazy cow. But this is not just for me, or by me, or by any one person. It's by one another. You have to serve and love and express your faith in provoking one another. And that's why I think Sunday service, whilst it is a great thing, a wonderful spiritual discipline we have, Sunday service and coming to Sunday service is not enough. It's not enough. Because Sunday service doesn't allow you to know one another, or at least get beneath the surface. It's never a deep enough relationship. Let me tell you, a typical conversation that can take place outside. After the service, you go on and say, "Hey, hi, John, how are you?" "Hey, great, man, I had a great week. How about you?" "Not too bad, and by the way, I got a new car." "Wow, a new car, what is it?" "Oh, this great car." "Hey, how's your wife?" "My wife's fine, she's still working." "And how's your kids?" "Well, they're going to school." "Hey, John, nice talking to you. Great fellowship today. See you next Sunday." You call that fellowship? You call that knowing one another? Would we be anywhere close to Hebrews 10:24 if that is all we have? No. No. Now, you have come to church. You have heard a sermon. But wherein is that privilege and responsibility to do the one another's? Therefore, I suggest to you that care groups, small groups, are the best place for us to be intentional in living out the one another's. You can't do this here. You're seated in rows. You're facing one guy. You don't hear one another. We've got to go to circles. And in our church, and in many churches, the only place you can get into circles meaningfully, intentionally, consistently, is small groups. Now, some of you are scared of going into circles because you feel like you have to open up your life. But my friends, you need it. And let me say this also, others need you. You need others, and others need you. And we are playing AWOL, all right, AWOL, Army. We are absence without official leave. When we as Christians say, "I don't want to be in community, I don't want to be in any groups where I have to do the one another's, and I'm still a faithful Christian follower of Jesus Christ." No, there's nothing like that. It doesn't work this way. It was John Wesley who says, "There is nothing more unchristian than a solitary Christian." He says, it's a paradox. How can you say you are a follower of Jesus if you are living a solitary life? You are not in community. You know, Jesus came. He's so powerful. He's so holy. He could live a solitary life, right? But he didn't. He gave himself to community, to the circle. And if we are followers of God, we follow Jesus. And if we say we love God, we will love people. And we will take an interest in lives, genuinely and consistently. Now, I say this, this is important for us. Gospel Light Christian Church. Some of you have been in Gospel Light for a long time. And you have classified yourself as, I've done all I can, I'm a good Christian. Because I have been in church and I do ministry. I want to ask you, is this a big gap in your life that the Lord maybe is speaking to you to fill up? I'm contributing, Pastor. Thank God for that. I'm giving, Pastor. Thank God for that. But are you in community? Are you living out Hebrews 10, 24, 25? This is a response to the gospel of Jesus. This is what it means to love God. Many of us have this mindset that, you know, I don't want to be too deep in relationships, I just want to serve God. So maybe you have heard about this Lone Ranger, Pinto, I think. Have you heard about the Lone Ranger? The Lone Ranger is this masked guy who, when he sees people in trouble, in need of help, he comes in, he helps them. But before people could get to know him, he rushes off. So he's always the Lone Ranger. I think in church, there are a lot of lone rangers. We wear a mask. I don't want people to know me too much, but when you call me for help, I'll help you lah. I'll do this ministry a bit, but I'll go off after that. I don't want to be in any deep relationship. Maybe a more modern equivalent would be the Spider-Man and the Superman. You know, they all have this mask, right? Don't want people to know who they are. Clark Kent's maybe not so good. Superman's disguise is not so good. But okay. Spider-Man, he's disguised. He comes in, he helps you, he swings away, and then nobody knows who he is. Wow, that's the kind of Christian I want to be. Wesley says nothing more unchristian than that. And by the way, if you don't notice, all these mass heroes have ego, not ego, but identity problems. They have emotional problems. They become very emo. Why? No community. What's the... Even Stan Lee knows. If you live alone, you have community, you have emo problems. You're out of whack. You go siao. I think there are many siao Christians in our church. You're driven to performance. You're driven to serve, but no community. It does you no good. In our church, we believe you've got to know, grow, go. Going and going and going and going and going without community is not going to last you very long. I'm not speaking just to the elite Christians, folks. Hebrews 10, 24, 25 is not given to the elite elders, pastors, deacons, ministry leaders. No, this is for everyone. Live out that community. It's the book of Acts. It's the book of Acts. They gathered from house to house. So I hope today you really think about this. Now, don't be in a care group because this is the church program. No, please don't do that. But be in a care group because you are biblically motivated to do so. You understand God's will. I'm not here to drive a program. I'm not here to get statistics. I'm concerned about your life, your spiritual life, and your obedience to God. That's what matters. And as far as I can see, in the scripture, the one another's are a vital expression of our faith. So take it seriously for yourself. Well, let me end off a little bit more positively then. Some years ago, I was in the UK, in London, and we went to a museum. I can't remember whether this is the British Museum or the Natural History Museum. I think it's Natural History. Yeah, I think this is a Natural History Museum. And when you walk in, you see this fossil, this skeleton of the dinosaur. Of course, favorite portion for my kids. But in the Natural History Museum, it's a rather spacious area. We also get to see this structure up there. And when I saw the flyer, the brochure, they say it's a sequoia. And then similar, never heard before. Sequoia. So I'm very curious. And it's right on top. It's usually the best part, right? I mean, it's like, wow, crown jewel. So I walked up and I had a closer picture of it. It really is a cross-section of a tree called a sequoia tree. It's a huge tree. It's a majestic tree, and when in full splendor, it is spectacular. The sequoia tree, the giant redwoods, are able to stand so tall, so straight, so strong, so majestic. Why? Because under the soil, beneath the ground, the roots of these giant trees are interlocking with other giant trees. The reason why they stand so tall and so strong is because they have deep roots and interlocking roots. It reminds me that the Christian life can never be tall and strong until we have deep interlocking roots one with another. Some of us look like tauge. You know tauge? Bean sprout. We fall. Why? No interlocking roots. It's never going to be big. Grow very fast. Tauge is very fast, right? 1-2 days, wow, come out already. But if you want to be a giant redwood, be in community. That's where you are blessed, you're encouraged, you're provoked, you're stirred, and that's where you bless, you encourage, you provoke, you stir one another. There is no shortcut. This is Bible. This is God's word. This is what Jesus gave to you. You say, why should I do all these things? Well, Jesus did everything for you. So my dear friends, my brothers and sisters in Christ, in the light of the gospel of Jesus Christ, I challenge you to three areas of your life. Number one, draw near to God in intimacy with Him. Personal worship, personal prayer, intimacy. For those of you who are going through hardships, hang on, would you? Because He is the anchor for your soul. Don't give up. Keep believing. Number three, watch this area of your life. Be intentional about the one another's. If you have not had anything like this, I want to say, why don't you try a care group? Join one. Obey God, not because this is a church program, but because this is the will of God in the Scripture. And see God grow you in time to be a giant redwood for His glory. Let's bow for a word of prayer together. These are expressions of faith. When God changes a man's heart, He will manifest a desire to draw near. And He will consistently work towards that. And He will also have that persevering faith. He doesn't jump ship. He doesn't give up. He keeps believing. Real faith is also evidenced by the practice of one another. Some of you have been hurt before in church. Maybe not in this church, but in a previous church, or previous churches. You have laid yourself bare, you've been vulnerable, you say, I want to commit to community, but you feel betrayed today, and you say, I can never get out of that, I will never be in community again. I say, what does Scripture say to you? Has God been wrong to give you community? No. Then trust Him. You may want to protect yourself by saying, I don't want to be in care group, but the counterintuitive thing, the obedient thing is the right thing. Maybe you have been putting this off, you have been serving in our church, you may even be an office bearer in our church, but you say, I don't want to be in care group, I don't want to be in community, I'm fine. You may look fine, but you're not fine. I'm afraid I'm a little bit harsh here, but I want you to see that this is not just a kind suggestion. This is a command. This is God's will. This is the path to the means of grace through which God will bless your life. I'm concerned for your soul. I'm concerned for your spiritual walk. And I believe if you make the right decisions and commitments today, you will be definitely better off. God's ways are always the better ways. Why do these things? Why so much effort? Why so much time? Why so much commitment to draw near, to go to community, to attend CG? It takes up so much of my time, yes. But Jesus gave his life, didn't he? He gave up his glory for you. And even the commands he gives you now are not burdensome. They glorify God and they bless you. If you have been wise enough to turn from sin to believe in Jesus, would you be wise enough to trust and obey? May God bless your heart to make the right choices. And if you're here today for the first time, you do not know Jesus, this is the greatest news of all. Jesus gives us access. With his shed blood and with his body that was sacrificed for us, you and I, sinful, absolutely unworthy people, can now come in full assurance because Jesus paid it all. So this morning, would you turn from sin and believe in Jesus Christ, God's Son, who is the Lamb, that sacrifice that takes away the sin of the world. Father, we thank you for this time, and would you continue to speak to our hearts. In this journey on earth, we may not see a lot of things, but we want to see the scriptures, obey it, and glorify you through it. We trust that as we obey you, we will always benefit. We will always be blessed. What a glory it sheds on our way when we trust and obey. So bless each one here, I pray. May Gospel Light be a church that goes more and more into the very will of God. We pray all this now in Jesus' name. Amen.